everyone, and welcome back to the 7th IESF World Championships in beautiful Seoul, South Korea. I am Artosis, joined by Rapid, and we are getting towards the end of this tournament.
Yeah, we've had some surprising results already. We saw Korea eliminated yesterday by a couple of the guys that we're about to see here today. So it's been a good tournament so far.
Yeah, a lot of upsets. You know, so many different countries from around the world compete here in Hearthstone and StarCraft II Legacy of the Void and League of Legends. But as you said, Korea, which has won how many IESFs now?
It's won the last three in a row, and I think the only time another country's won IESF was Sweden. Nobody talks about that. Korea is so dominant, and yet I think they just got eliminated from Hearthstone, from StarCraft as well. Yeah, and so kind of the hope for Korea lies in League of Legends later on today. But for right now, we're about to cast some Hearthstone. Pretty cool game. Had the new wing come out today.
And yeah, I believe it did. I don't think we're using those
cards. No. If we see some cards that I haven't played with yet, I'm going to be like, okay.
Sick. That I card. Get my phone out and unlock them during the cast.
Just like Google the cards. Oh, that one does that. Okay, yeah. But so no new cards today, but we are going to see the first two wings of some exploration going on. Love the discover mechanic. We got to see that a couple times yesterday. But these games are actually pretty short and sweet. It's just best of threes up until the grand final, which is best of five.
And it's conquest format, so as soon as you win the deck, that deck is going to be going out of there. As you see, here's our top four bracket. Yesterday, we got to cast Serbia going up against Korea, which our Serbian player did end up winning. And that's going to be our first match for today. It's going to be Romania going up against Serbia for that coveted spot in the finals.
Right. Dominator taking on Moody is going to be our first matchup. And, of course, we're going to be having the second semifinal match a little bit later on in the day after some StarCraft. But, yeah, Romania always represented very, very well in international tournaments. They were actually the only game only team to take a game off of Korea yesterday in League of Legends. So some pretty impressive stats already.
Yeah. Romania, I've gotten to go there a couple times for DreamHack and whatnot, and they have a very passionate, very large esports scene. A lot of people wouldn't think that, but it is a fact. Romanians are hardcore nerds.
Absolutely, and you can see Moody right there on your screen, ready to represent his country. That sick rock music's like, I'm here to play a collectible card game.
And as opponent here, we have our Serbian player. You can see he's pretty hardcore here as well. He's chewing some gum. I think I heard that this guy was a Magic pro before, so...
Yeah, he's actually been around in one kind of card game or another for quite a while, and now he's here to play some Cardstone with the rest of us.
I think he's our oldest player in the tournament as well. When
really?
I was going through the birth dates, I believe he's actually as old as I am, which means that basically he's a dinosaur.
It's like an ancient nerd.
Yeah. I believe he's about 32 years old, so...
Holy cow.
This guy is someone that absolutely could take this down. Yesterday, we saw him playing Paladin and Druid, and I think that in this type of format where you just get...
Yeah,
I mean,
you get two chances,
yeah,
and that's it.
That's it. You lose twice, you're out. Those two decks absolutely can beat every single deck in the format, so
right.
I like the way that he's approaching this tournament.
Yeah, absolutely. And so those will be the decks that he brings here today, and especially Paladin. We just saw how incredibly devastating it could be yesterday. It's like you don't even have to have good cards in your hand. You just draw them right off the top of the deck. One drop, two drop, three, and all the way through. So very,
and
very
six
strong
drop
class.
Mysterious Challenger. Let's not ever forget that.
We had six mana Dr. Boom yesterday, too.
That's
so
true.
Some pretty effective card combos to go with. So really excited to get this underway. Of course, we've got only one more day of IESF left after that until the grand finals tomorrow. So if you guys haven't caught the games up until now, definitely go back and watch those. See how we got here today.
Yeah, we've had some good matches so far. Last night, we actually had the Archon Show match
between
four of the best
true.
Players in the world, SOS and Maru going up against Zest and Life. And definitely check that out if you didn't get to catch that.
Yeah, IESF, not just one esport, it's bringing a lot of esports, a lot of countries together to compete together. And in case you guys are wondering how that all works, like depending on which events you win as a country, you get points for winning each different event. And then, of course, the country with the most points at the end to crown the IESF World Champion.
That's right. Definitely a very nice thing for your country to get that type of pride together. But looks like our first Hearthstone match is starting off, so we'll go ahead and jump into that game right away here. And any predictions going forward?
Well, I can predict the classes because I'm cheating, but we should have that up on your screen here just a second. So as far as predictions go, I'm going to guess Paladin is still going to be a pretty good class to run, so maybe a little bit of an edge to Dominator.
You're brave saying Paladin will be a good class here.
I'm going out on a limb. I'm making the hard decisions here, but I mean, to be fair, we've got new cards that affect all classes, so... I don't know, it could go either way. Of course, something tells me we're about to get into a Paladin game right here.
That's right, and already a Secret Keeper out there on the board.
I believe this is the exact same start he had yesterday.
Very close to it.
Secret Keeper, and it what do you know? He's got a 2-drop, and then, well, not really a 3-drop, but he has the ability to just, you know, hero power his secret, power that Secret Keeper up.
Well, so it looks like he's probably playing against a Patron Warrior here, so... does have that inner rage in hand, kind of pointing towards that. And, of course, you know, the card that always starts in your hand as a warrior player, Fiery Wind Axe, as many people call it.
Yeah, pretty much. It's
in his hand, and he's probably expecting that because that's Hearthstone, right?
Oh, and to be fair, as great a start as Paladins are, you know, touted as having, you know, the 1-drop into 2-drop all the way up, Fiery War Axe really limits a lot of that early pressure, able to take a couple of minions off the board early on.
Absolutely the case. We'll see. I'm imagining he's going to go ahead and play that here to deal with this Knife Juggler. A lot of pressure already coming out of our Paladin player. And, you know, I like the fact that he has this Divine Favor. I feel like this is really going to help him against Control Warrior.
Yeah, definitely. If you you know, have a large hand size that are going up against you, just draw a ton of cards. Sounds good to me. And to be fair, for the Warrior player, Moody, I'm actually really proud that he's not going for that just a card true heart fatigue warrior.
Yeah.
So we're not sitting here for like another 20 minutes or so. But yeah, Fiery War Axe, that's the play, and it's going to start to, you know, limit the cards being played out on the field. But turns out, one card for one mana, you play it, you get a one buff on your creature, and you're also going to have that Paladin secret out there, too.
Well, right now, with that Repentance out, we're going to have to see what Moody ends up doing here. Kind of looking at this hand, I have to say, this is pretty scary for our Warrior player because of that Divine Favor. That's going to be a really sick play, probably on turn 5 coming up here.
So many
and the Patron Warrior, a class that wants to stack up a bunch of cards early so they can, you know, drop them all for big combos on, you know, specifically like, you know, turn 5, turn 6, if you want to set up some weapons and stuff like that. But, I mean, there's no Deathbite in hand. You definitely want to have that early on for the Patron Warrior. And next turn, if we see the Shredder come down, there's going to be some good Divine Favors later
on. Yeah, certainly the case. Well, does go ahead and play this Acolyte out. Gets it reduced to just one health there, so only going to be able to draw him one card. That's kind of annoying, because as you said, you know, with the Patron deck, you really want to draw a lot of cards to be able to get into those combos, and especially the Grim Patrons.
Yeah, and for a long time, like when Hearthstone first came out, the big problem with Warrior is that you just had no card draw. It was so hard to get those, and now we, you know, come full circle here for Patron Warrior. You just have so many different ways to draw cards in your deck. Tyrion Portraying, probably not the card he wanted to see here, but it's interesting to see like the two different like perspectives for both players. You've got Moody, who's like, you know, very carefully like counting things out on his fingers, he's calculating, and Dominator just like, you know, sit back, chewing some gum.
Yeah,
he's here to kill nerds and chew bubble gum, and
he's center. He's thinking, yeah, the Duke Nukem style of him. He's literally just sitting there like, oh, this is so easy. Okay, he's like, well, now I have a card that costs 4, and I play that on turn 4.
It's like the game plays itself.
Yeah. So many. It's like, wow, this is so easy. I get a mana every turn. Nothing like Magic the Gathering.
Don't even have to worry about pesky land cards. So, yeah, I mean, Tyrion pretty dead. But, I mean, what are we looking at here for Moody? This is turn 4, so no Lothabs just yet. Although he does have the coin if he really wants to make that happen.
Well, I think he's looking at this and saying, oh, I'm only at 21 health. That's a pretty strong board. But not a lot of cards left in his opponent's hand, so he can be a little bit liberal with what he uses here.
Now, if he expects the Divine Favor, then he's going to want to, you know, empty his hand as quickly as possible. And to be fair, you know, you've got 2 0-cost cards, 2 1-cost cards, so that's something that he can actually do. And it does look like he's going to go for the Lothab, which, of course, we as omniscient observers can say it's a pretty good play because it blocks that Divine Favor.
I would definitely say so, but you know what? The top decks are real, getting into this true silver. It's that's a great draw right now. But do you use it on Lothep, or are you going to go face?
Well, as his name may suggest, he's a little bit, has a propensity for doom.
Propensity for doom, you say?
Dr. Doominator, even. Because he did get Doomsayer off of a Shredder at the worst possible time yesterday.
Yes, indeed.
But he still came back and won the game. Yeah. So, that's how good Paladin is.
His Doom Shredder here.
Oh my gosh. I think he knows about that. He's got, went back to his hotel last night. He's like trying to sleep, but he just has nightmares of Doomsayer all over again. So, wants to make sure that doesn't happen here. So, preserves the Shredder, keeps that on the board. And of course, always better to keep the monster on the board.
Yeah.
Able to get some more value.
So many choices.
Well, I guess our patron warrior here from Moody has actually slowed down the game pretty well. Yeah, he's only at 17 health, but he has a couple taunts. He still has plenty of removal here as well. And it's up to him to decide here what exactly he's going to do, because anything he plays out, this true silver can just deal with.
Zone. Yeah, absolutely anything. Even Dreadsail Corsair, you just throw it down, it doesn't matter. There's no weapon to make that cheaper, and really, this is kind of the awkward place when you're playing Patron Warrior, especially this new version of Patron Warrior. Sometimes you just have really awkward hands that can't do anything, so you can play down things like this Unstable Ghoul, but it really doesn't accomplish very much.
No, certainly not. In fact, even just looking at this, it's like playing both these out, you're just giving these away. Yeah, it's going to deal a little bit of damage to Paladin, but he doesn't care.
Yeah, absolutely not. And in fact, if you trade this out correctly, you can actually leave one up and then have it, just eat the Noble Sacrifice next turn. Mm-hmm. It does set up for yet another good Divine Favor. I think he's going to get four cards off that.
Oh man, that's so sick. Three mana and a card for four cards.
Oh, and he can
so
even
insane.
Play the Owl to silence one of the cards on the field. This is pretty good. Hey, Paladin, if you guys want to go home and play some of that, you'll have a good time.
I heard Paladin's a good deck.
Yeah, well, I heard it was a terrible deck, Artosis. My friend's just trolling me?
Yeah, I guess so.
Probably.
Looks like he's going to go ahead and clear this in a more messy way than using that Owl up. Maybe saving that for a little bit later on, realizing that he's in a nice advantage here.
Well, it is going to make him take a little bit more damage from True Silver Champion, but he's going to heal some of that off anyway, and he's not really too concerned about that. He's got Tyrion Forgering in a couple turns anyway. A Paladin with a 7 drop into an 8 drop, and they're both both some of the best cards
in
the game.
Look at that. Seriously, everything has worked out so perfectly for Doominator. The fact that he will hit an on-curve Dr. Boom and an on-curve Tyrion.
The only thing he actually missed is Mysterious Challenger, so it's like, you're playing Secret Paladin, you don't get the Mysterious Challenger, but you don't even need it.
No, I guess he really does not. But you know what? I'm holding out hope. I think that he can play a turn 9 Mysterious Challenger.
I believe.
With something else fantastic. Oh. A Divine Favor again, perhaps? I'm not so sure.
Perhaps. I mean, to be fair, Moody is most likely going to have a very large hand for a while. He has the ability to use, I guess, Inner Rage to draw more cards. He's going to get a Death Bite off that, so that's definitely a good card to have if you want to get those patron combos off or maybe activate Grom, but he might not even live that long.
He's in a lot of trouble if you look at it, right? Like, I think he's going to have to execute the Shredder and probably armor up, and I mean, that's not what you want to be doing. That's not what you want to use these cards for, but he doesn't have anything going on.
Yeah, I mean, he's got double executes. They can't execute his own minion.
Oh, he can't? Are you sure?
I mean, I thought I would ask you. I feel like you're an expert.
I'm pretty sure he can.
All right. Well,
I've never tried personally. But I'm fairly certain that can target anything.
Good to know. All right. Well, here comes the Dr. Boom. We're about to get a little bit more serious because that stays alive for one more turn. I don't know what there is to deal with that. Well, now I do because he just drew the card. But Whirlwind, it's a pretty good idea.
Yeah, Whirlwind is an okay play here. And with that execute in hand, I mean, he actually starts to clean up very, very quickly. The thing is that which secret is this?
That is maybe. Noble Sacrifice.
Okay. Because I was going to say, if that's like Redemption, and he gets back the Shredder, that's so painful.
Yeah, you just get more and more drops. Cut first.
Oh, sick.
Wow, a lot of damage from those bombs. Not as much as we saw yesterday. We had like 8 damage to the face from bombs that went off. But now he will be able to execute Dr. Boom.
And this is turning around a little bit. We can play this Dread Corsair as well with this.
And that's actually a pretty good turn. He was able to clear most of the board. Unfortunately, won't be able to deal with the cut purse. But like you said, Dread Corsair coming out.
Those coins.
Yeah. They'll be coming in there. And to be fair, I guess it actually does make a difference with the coin.
Yeah.
Because you can play Tyrion and then a secret on top of it.
Absolutely the case. Let's see what he ends up doing here. I'd imagine that Tyrion is going to fly out of his hand pretty quickly.
I guess the other option would, instead of Tyrion, would be something like silencing the Dread Corsair and then playing Lotheb and maybe some secrets there, because, I mean, he's going to have to trade his board into it if he doesn't.
Yeah, you know, that's, I don't think that that's a very bad play at all, but with my opponent having used an execute last turn, I think that that Tyrion is probably what I would be looking to play pretty quickly here.
Yeah, one thing about, we talked about the cut purse, it actually didn't give him, you know, the coin that he needed to play a secret here, because he does have redemption that would revive Tyrion for Drake.
Yeah, that's true.
Pretty crazy combo.
Oh my god. yeah, you do have to attack the hero for that. Unfortunately, with that taunter in the way, not able to work out.
What's the best way to deal with Tyrion right here? It's not BGH-able, so you can't get rid of it there. You're going to have to hit it with your face at some point. Or, I mean, you could play Grommash, but then that's your entire turn.
Yeah, I know. I mean, he's at 8 health right now, so this is pretty rough.
Oh, my god. I was just checking what the rest of the cards were. It's like, oh my gosh, this is actually ridiculous. I mean, to be fair, it was actually
He's looking at the cut purse. He's like, wait, why didn't I get that coin?
Yeah, he's like, wait a second. How does that card work?
Wait a minute. I wanted to put redemption out with this. It's like one of the best combos in the game.
Yeah, but I mean, it turns out he doesn't even need that. Playing Tyrion itself is a pretty good combo. I was actually really impressed that Moody was able to deal with the last turn as effectively as he was, but cruel Taskmaster.
Yeah, a great combo here to utilize that BGH, but look, that 5 attack weapon is more than enough.
Yeah, not going to make it much longer here, and I think he knows it's getting close to over. Now, Haunted Creeper is not really the greatest draw to pick up at that point, but I mean, Lotheb's going to secure himself, not necessarily safety from Execute, but it's going to use up most of the mana if he wants to go for that.
Well, we'll go ahead and hit for 5 right there. Of course, his opponent can armor up next turn, but he's getting so close to death at this point.
Oh my god, yeah, 21-5. Small discrepancy there. 2 more Paladin Secrets coming out, and we still haven't seen a Mysterious Challenger, so...
Well, you know what? When he gets it, it's just going to be a 6-6 at this point. He's played like 5 secrets this game. How many does he really have in that deck?
Oh, I know there were a couple of versions of Mysterious Challenger Secret Paladin that only ran like 4 or 5 secrets. So when you include Secret Keeper, you're probably going to be running a lot more than that.
Yeah.
So. Might still get a few.
He could be running a few more in there. We'll see if he ends up drawing it pretty soon. He's gone through quite a bit of his deck already, too.
But how do you clear this out? I guess the biggest answer is just going to be running into Lotheb, but that's going to set you very, very low. And is there a way to come back from this? There's a lot of damage on the field to take, and if you want to use the Whirlwind effect from Deathbite and then Execute, you can't really play anything else that turn.
Yeah, it's a little bit rough. I think he has to sack even, like... the thing is, he has to actually hit the BGH into the Spider and then use the Execute with his Whirlwind effect, or he dies, because he can only armor up for 2 health here.
And he does have to armor up at some point, because he's going to take 5 damage from the weapon next turn, even if he clears the board.
And he has to clear the board.
Oh my god, this is not looking good for Moody. He's very resilient, so he's been able to deal with, you know, the Dr. Boom threat, the Tyrion threat, but at this point, it's just getting so close to dead.
What can he even draw for the next turn? Because there's 2 charges left on this axe.
Reno Jackson!
Yeah. I'm sure he's playing that. Oh,
I mean,
man,
everybody's
I want
playing
it
that's like a cool kid's card. If you're not playing that in your deck, do you even Hearthstone? It's a
do you even Hearthstone?
I mean,
I love
seen,
it.
We've seen a lot of Reno at tournaments like DreamHack Winter. Got a chance to check out a lot of that action, but now
that's it.
What's the comeback here? You can't get enough health from the armor. You can't win the game this turn. There's no activators for Grom, even that's not enough damage, and finally Moody, after dealing pretty admirably with so many options, he's gonna give it up. Dominator taking game number 1.
You know, Moody actually did a really good job, considering Dominator was consistently ahead. He always had what he needed on each and every turn. Like, his first 8 turns were basically flawless plays, like the best plays that you could imagine, aside from the Mysterious Challenger, who was mysteriously missing.
Well, now we're actually going to see no more Paladins, so we're done with that class. Dominator already clocking in with a win. And to be fair, Moody is actually bringing Paladin himself, so he has the opportunity to go back to Paladin in the second game and try to use that strength in that class to win it.
And look, I think the Paladin is absolutely capable of picking up a deck, of course, against a win against, of course, anything. But I love that Dominator is playing Druid here as well. It's just like, that is a deck that can beat absolutely anything.
Right.
In field.
Turns out Wild Growth is a pretty good card. Yeah. Innervate also possibly pretty good.
Especially if you draw like that. If we could see another turn six Dr. Boom or something, it's like Dominator will be able to go to the finals.
It's like, hey, Dominator making it all the way through Korea as well. Pretty impressive win there yesterday if you guys got a chance to check that out. And already just one game away. This is only a best of three, so he's only got to win one more match before he makes it there to the finals tomorrow.
I know. It's so crazy that we're already in the semifinals here.
I know, right?
But... If he makes it, that is a big deal for Serbia, I would say, to be able to go through. And the thing is, it's not like Korea or Romania are bad. These have some of the best Hearthstone players in the world.
Absolutely. Guys like RDU, been one of the top Hearthstone players forever. It's a heavy banner to bear when you come here to represent Romania.
Absolutely.
You have so many other good players.
They have a lot of top-end guys from Romania, so... it's a pretty big deal if he can punch through here. The Serbian scene doesn't have as much dominance.
All right, well, we were talking about Druid and how strong a class that is. He does have Wild Growth in and Innervate in his hand. I feel like we just talked about that. So
that's pretty good.
That's how you can tell he's a good Druid player.
Absolutely.
But, of course, on the other side, Moody also has a pretty good starting hand. He's got that shielded mini-bot.
Yeah, this is not so bad, really, when you look at it. The shielded mini-bot, the knife juggler. I mean, of course, he has the muster and... Call to Arms can be pretty cool if it goes off with that muster. So,
good combo to see maybe a little bit later on. I think the choice right now is, do you play the Knife Juggler first and get maybe a little bit greedy, or do you just go for the really effective play in the Shield and Mini-Bot? And I think he's either trying to draw out a Wrath here or see what the play is. Now, Innervate into Keeper is not a bad option here.
Yeah, you know what? Is he going to find a better place to play that Innervate? I don't think so. And then the Wild Growth on turn three actually bridges right into that Druid of the Claw. So I think that's a great play right there. What a great draw here from Dominator.
Yeah, I mean, starting off with the ability to just get two extra mana for free. Now, he's a little bit low on cards in his hand. That's always sort of the downside to playing Innervate, is it does decrease your hand size. But he is coming up on turns that'll be able to get him, more cards back into his hand. I don't think we're going to see any like Nourish or anything crazy like that for extra ramp, but he will be able to play into turn five right on curve with a Wild Growth next turn.
Well, right now, Moody might be getting a little bit moody looking at this. Everything working out perfect for his opponent. Of course, as a Hearthstone pro, you always watch what card they draw and what they play, so he knows that was top decked there. So could be a bit frustrated, but now the question just comes up, like, does he want the shield mini bot or does he want the muster?
I mean, muster for battle, how does a druid really even clear that out? I mean, you can hero power one of them down, you can use the keeper into the other, and that does take care of a couple of them, but it still leaves the opportunity to put one on the board that might not be able to get cleared out. You just want to keep that body out there, and of course, coming into the next turn, he'll be able to play something like, you know, that True Silver Champion that will be able to deal with that keeper relatively well.
Well, looks like the combo now in hand for Druid, so that's something we definitely have to keep in mind for the rest of the game here as he approaches turn 9.
It's a little bit early, but at the same time, not really...
You don't really want it this early on.
Right.
But the fact that he has it does make him very, very dangerous going forward.
And it does kind of put things on a clock, too, because when you get to turn 9, you know that you have that crazy burst damage, especially if he has a board built up.
Yeah, well... He's actually thinking about using hero power here. I don't really like it, though. I think you have to play that Wild Growth, right?
I mean, if you don't play Wild Growth, your hand does nothing for a very long time. So the ability to, you know, at least play out a taunt next turn if that's something that he feels necessary, or we'll have that 5 mana, depending on what else he runs in his deck. I'm not sure what other 5 drops he's included, but certainly Druids of the Claw is a great thing to drop there. Probably Lotheb in the deck as well.
Well, let's see what we're going to have pop out here from Moody. Look at his hand. It's still actually quite a nice hand here.
I mean, it's a paladin hand. Yeah. So what can you say? He's got multiple very strong options. You can True Silver right here. You can Shredder to build the board up. And I don't even disagree with the Shredder here. You can still leave the Keeper down there. All it's going to do is clear 1/1s.
Yeah.
But I don't know. At the same time, what do you think here? If you play the True Silver, then you get rid of your 1/3 weapon. It's not that valuable anyway.
Yeah.
But
I like the 4-3, to be honest. Just build that board up a little bit. But hey, he's going to go ahead and just remove his keeper. It's going to keep his little two dudes alive, more likely. And
well,
having
the
weapon developed is really nice, too.
Right. Competitive spirits, you also a little bit more attracted. You've got a bigger board out there. So we'll see how long this stays up. Had to imagine we're going to see Druid of the Claw here.
Yeah, but even seeing Druid of the Claw, you see its death on the board already. So, you know, that's suddenly it looks a little bit less cool.
It's like, yeah, you're not too cool if you're just going to die as soon as you get played.
Yeah. Now,
I guess the other
and then
option
you have three
is...
spells left in your hand. It's like, well, that sucks. I think
yeah.
that there's probably an argument for playing your Wrath to cycle and using your Hero Power possibly on the other 1-1.
Right, yeah, you just Wrath, Hero Power, you get some more card draw. And after playing that Innervate early, it was a little bit down in cards anyway. And looks like that is the option he's going to go for. Not really using that Force of Nature, or not Force of Nature, the Wild Growth early to great effect. I think he's floated one mana a couple of turns in a row. He's had
yeah,
Hero Power twice
yeah.
already.
That can happen, which is really funny because you're like, well, Wild Growth is one of the best cards. And then you float a mana every turn. You're like, I have one less card in my hand now, and it did nothing.
Right. Innervate, too. I mean, it was good to have that keeper turn early to maybe get a little bit of tempo, but where's your tempo now?
Well, neither of them are having any tempo at this point, but let's see here. Going to go ahead and drop this Shredder. That seems pretty obvious. And going to play the Competitive Spirit now. What do you think about that one?
Well, I guess it works well with Shredder because it's very hard to deal with both halves of Shredder, like the Death Rattle coming back. Outside of just swiping the Shredder right now or playing a charging bear, it doesn't. It's not really a way to deal with that. So Competitive Spirit's going to power that up a little bit more. And let's see, what do we have as a way to deal with that?
Oh, Mysterious Challenger. Oh, okay.
What turn is it, Artosis?
It's turn six.
There's a good six drop card in Paladin decks. And while we didn't see Doominator draw that when he was playing Paladin,
yeah.
right on curve, I guess that does make Moody a better Paladin player.
Oh, certainly. You can see it. That's you watch. He'll draw Dr. Boom next turn for sure. All right, so he's going to get three secrets out right. there. That's, I mean, what a good card. I don't think that there's even an argument for really attacking this 4-6 at the moment, to be honest.
Why would you need to?
Yeah.
It dies next turn in the Mysterious Challenger. You've still got a very strong board, and it's going to take a lot to deal with that this next turn. You're not Dominator's not close to turn 9, so there's no combo to just clear everything out.
Yeah.
I mean, Swipe's going to be a good card next turn, but is it really good enough to get him back in the tempo war?
Well, he is going to go ahead and kill this off, perhaps.
Doomsayer. No, he's actually just going to run the weapon into it.
Oops. Okay.
Okay.
I mean, I guess that clears him up for a Coghammer swing next turn. So if this Druid doesn't trade into anything, the Coghammer can just clear out. And also, if he does attack... a defender can pump out and kill him, so.
Might be a little bit scary. It always also scary to leave a Druid minion on the board, because then they just keep building it up little by little, and then you just kind of combo to death. So there's a couple of Darnassus aspirants. I think those are a little bit behind schedule, but let's go ahead and see what kind of secrets we get procced here. We got Noble Sacrifice, almost, definitely going to come out there,
yeah.
So that's going to get down. It's going to get revived and avenged.
Oh, wow, that's big.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah, that does make it BGH-able if that does come up here in just a second. But, wow, that is a lot of damage on the board.
Well, there's all of his secrets, so pretty scary stuff. This is a really nice play, though, with that swipe. And, he actually dealt with that better than I thought he would end up doing.
Yeah, it was really on the Avenge. When the Avenge went on Mysterious Challenge, it's like, okay, I just need to deal with that one big card. And it always feels bad to kill Shredder on your turn, too, because it essentially gives the next minion charge.
Yeah.
So, leaving that up, it's only 5 damage or 26 health. Not too dangerous at all, but, man, this Coghammer is just really going to make it difficult to deal with.
How do you even deal with this? And look, he can play his whole hand out as well. Like, yeah, it's going to give him nothing left in hand, but that board, how do you deal with that?
Exactly. You've got double Divine Shield, you've got Taunt, you've got Death Rattle with a Revive effect. There's a weapon in there to clear our tempo on the board. If he draws Owl this turn, that's pretty good. Emperor, not quite so much,
yeah.
But it does discount the combo.
That's true, and that's actually a really, really big deal. But look, this is 7, 8, 9, 10 damage on the board right now.
God.
He's at 19 life. This is getting very, very scary, and the more I look at this, the more I'm thinking next turn he might have to clear with his combo.
No, I think the Darnassus Aspirin actually may telegraph the combo in hand, because the idea is that you play that just to have another minion on the board. Mm. So if you leave the minion up, Duminator's saying, you want to leave that minion up? Maybe a combo coming out next turn. But with Divine Shields and Taunts, that even that's not going to be very effective.
Yeah.
Okay, second Mysterious Challenger. Unfortunately, he actually drew into Avenged, and he will be having a couple more secrets drawn off that Mysterious Challenger.
Okay, well, I guess we know that one is a Noble Sacrifice for sure.
Right. The other one, probably a redemption.
Yeah, redemption. It should be a redemption, you're right.
Okay, because he's got the second Avenge in hand. But at the same time, even with very low hand size, Moody has still been able to utilize almost all of his mana every turn, so still very, very cost-effective hand up until now. But to be fair, Duminator doesn't really have anything either.
No, I mean, quickly. He has that combo, which he's probably going to have to end up using, and that sucks, but this is the way of things.
Yeah, I mean, even with the since turn one, that innervate early on, lower hand size, less cards to deal with, and now the cards he has are not really the ones he needs. Mounted Raptor. It's a new card.
Yeah.
It's like a mini Shredder.
I really like the Mounted Raptor, but I mean, he can't really play it here. He has to use... He has to go ahead and use the combo, right? Otherwise, he's dead.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, not 100% dead, but so low on health, he's not going to be able to come back. He has to clear.
Well, all you really need to do is kill off the pilot and Shredder.
And get a Doomsayer.
Hey, it happened yesterday. Maybe he's got that karma built up from getting it yesterday. He gives another one here. I don't know about that, but combo should be the play.
And, you know, he does have a proclivity towards Doom, so... it could happen.
I mean, we were joking about that, but I think you said something yesterday, like, right before it happens, like, there's no possible way that could come out there. But yeah, here comes the combo. It's going to proc that get down, and it means that he's only really going to be able to use these strengths to kill off the Shredder. Does this give him the Doomsayer that he needs? Because otherwise, he's looking at death in the next two turns.
Yeah, he certainly is. Well... looks like, I mean, outclose the defender. He does queue up all of his moves right away, and that isn't it.
Yeah, boxing its shadows is not a good way to win things out. And with that Avenge popping, it's 9-8 Mysterious Challenger for the second time this game.
Yep, well, that's a lot of damage on the board right there, I have to say. That is, in fact, 17 damage on the board, I have to say. And that means that it looks like Moody is going to be able to tie this up.
Yeah, absolutely. This is one of the more even matchups. We had mostly 2-0s over the course of the early group stage on day one. And so coming into this, it's kind of refreshing to see, what do you know, Paladin winning both games.
Yeah, who'd have thought that would ever happen in a Hearthstone tournament? So looks like both the Paladin decks out of the way. And that is actually going to bring us to Druid against Patron Warrior for our last match here.
All right, Druid, we talked about how it's good versus just about everything. And you can really see Moody there on your screen, maybe a little bit Moody himself after losing the first game, but he's able to come back, bring it back from Romania, and now Serbia feeling a little bit of pressure.
Yeah. Well, what do you think about the matchup for Patron Warrior against Druid here, that Druid with the ramp?
Well, before it used to be a Patron Warrior kind of playing against itself. It's like, if you draw a million cards and you get your combo, then that's great. But last time we saw Patron Warrior be played, it was really kind of awkward. It didn't really do a whole lot. So it all depends on which Patron Warrior shows up here today.
Yeah, I guess if you get that nice quick start and you actually start getting a bunch of patrons on the board on turn 5 or turn 6, it's going to be basically everything except maybe Paladin, but... we'll see what kind of openings they actually get to start here, because Druid sometimes falls flat on its face as well if it gets no ramp and a bunch of high-cost cards.
All right, well, let's go ahead and get into game number 3. Coming your way here, Romania. Coming back in game number 2, Serbia, though. Strong start to the game. We'll see which one advances the grand finals tomorrow.
All right, well, we're starting this out on turn 2. As you can see, the Aspirin coming down immediately here for Druid. A very good early play, and I mean, this is, he has that innervate in hand, so he could have some very powerful turns coming up if this isn't dealt with.
All right, now one of the downsides we saw earlier of innervate is that sometimes it leaves you with a pretty low hand size.
Yeah.
And he's got very high cost minions in hand anyway, so I mean, Duminator, he's running an. All right. I drew a deck with a lot of early game options too, so he's got Darnassus Aspirants, mm-hmm. he's got those the Raptors in his in his deck as well, so not having any of those this early, really gonna hurt.
Yeah, maybe, well, you know, from what we've seen from Duminator, sometimes he does go ahead and draw into those nice curve-filling cards, but as of right now, we do have Moody trying to figure out what he wants to do about this Aspirant. Does he try to play out a minion here? Does he do something like a Slam? I don't see a great play for him this turn, to be honest.
Slam feels bad, man, and he's also, I guess that's what he's going to go for, just valuing drawing cards over. Oh, he actually draws into the inner fridge.
Hey, there you go.
All right, so this is the Patron Warrior that's showing up.
Yes.
Kind of feels bad to use two cards to kill one early on, but, I mean, they're pretty free because he was just able to draw them anyway. And another Darnassus Aspirant.
Hey, man, I like that play right there. Save that innervate for one of these bigger plays. You don't need that as your Drake out right now, especially when your opponent has the coin. You know that that can be taken out pretty easily.
Right, and it would have been Deathbite in hand. And this is a much better Patron Warrior hand than we saw in game one. He's got the weapon, he's got lots of draw abilities in his hand, he's got he's just able to draw into Inner Rage and clear that out, so
even
already
has
a much
this,
better start.
He even has this Dread Corsair right now. He can have a fantastic turn here, and maybe then he can just move forward very easily from there, drawing plenty of cards. He has his Acolyte in hand. It's looking much better for Moody this game than before with Dread Warrior.
Now, Duminator does have some ways to maybe come back in that with some value. He will be able to innervate into Emperor, which will then give you even more mana back by discounting the rest of the high-cost cards in hand. The other option, I guess, would be just going for like a Hero Power Wrath again, but it does not feel very good.
It certainly doesn't feel good, but you know, you do something like, let's say you innervate out your Tarzan here. 100% it dies. There's just, I mean, he has the Deathbite ready, so in fact, wow, that would just be so painful.
And it's a pretty awkward turn after that, too, depending on what he draws, of course. So top decks always possible, and he is going to go with the Wrath play.
I like it. I think that this is good. Save that Innervate for later on. Like, maybe Boom next turn. Maybe he just plays everything on curve from here. I'm not exactly sure how he's going to want to go about that, but I think it's a much more solid play than just throwing out Tarzan to die.
Right. I mean, discounting Dr. Boom feels pretty good. Turn 6 is great, but he has Innervate to get it out early, so he doesn't need to do that redundantly. So, gonna get a swipe, but it does look like Innervating out this Dr. Boom is the play.
All right. Let's see how this goes for him.
Looks like one Death Rattle minion versus two Death Rattle minions.
Oh, man. Dr. Flame Strike is here. This is always a very scary card to have to try to deal with.
Now, to be fair, I mean, there's no Execute in hand, but there is an Unstable Ghoul.
Yeah.
So if you just use the Whirlwind effect, throw down maybe the Patron this turn, you can get some of those started up.
Yeah, that's a possibility.
So many.
I wouldn't mind watching a little bit of Gamble, throwing down your Taunt as well as the Acolyte, try to get those Boom Bots to do your bidding.
Well, I was going to say, like, if you throw down the Patron and then use the Whirlwind effect to clear Boom Bots, that can actually propagate a bunch more Patrons if they hit correctly.
Oh, wow.
Okay.
That's always a fun card, but
so now he can actually Battle Rage to draw cards and then not save his Whirlwind effect for the next turn.
All right, let's see what he goes for here. He's going to go ahead and play this Acolyte out, and all right, it's time to see what will these Boom Bots decide to kill.
Oh, man, if that's if everything dies on board, then that's obviously like just super, super bad, but able to use Battle Rage now for two cards. He doesn't get the Acolyte to do any more than that, but still a decent hand.
All right, well, he does draw into another Dread Corsair here.
Discount your Wild Growth to one mana.
Oh, man. Well, I guess he's... I think you have to save that to draw later on, but there wasn't really another play here. You may as well play that on curve as opposed to a 4-4 Azure Drake, so...
Yeah, I mean, you do want to get some cards back into your hand, so most likely Azure Drake coming out next turn, but... I don't know. Like, who's really ahead? I feel like sometimes it's inevitable for the Patron Warrior. Like, you just get so many cards in your hand...
Well, look at that hand size, and it's a quality hand, too. He has two patrons here. He has another Whirlwind effect in his hand already. He has the Unstable Ghoul as well. Like, in the next few turns, he's going to be able to set up absolutely everything that he needs.
Right, and Moody knows that because Dominator isn't playing the best class in Hearthstone, he doesn't have to worry about Divine Favor.
That's true.
He can just keep as many cards in his hand as he wants, as opposed to the first time he played Patron Warrior that he did get Divine Favored for like four cards or something. So Patron Warrior's got six mana, so what are the options? You play the Patron, you don't play the Patron, probably not, just going to set up for a Deathbite.
All right, I like this. Like, yeah, you have that execute, but I don't think you're really that worried about your health right now. Of course, combos and stuff can come out, but with that taunt in the way, he can't die in the next turn.
Right. I mean, Innervate into combo, if those were the three cards, then that's pretty scary.
Yeah.
But he still wouldn't have died with the Dread Corsair out there. So she's going to go ahead, draw some cards. He's thinking about... Oh, yeah, definitely better to see what you draw first.
Yeah, I definitely agree with that. You may as well. And it gives you that extra damage anyways if you still want to do it. But hey, that's part of the combo right there. And our warrior is low on health. This still could go to Dominator.
Man, so close. Just depending on what cards get drawn here in the next few turns. Does have the ability to clear the Corsair off the field with Swipe if he wants to this turn. But always feels kind of weird to just use Swipe as a damage spell.
Yeah, it always does. But... you know, dealing a couple damage to your opponent, removing that Dread Corsair out of the way can be pretty nice.
Time waits for no
one. So he is considering other options.
It's always kind of the struggle of Hearthstone, and especially here versus Patron Warrior. He knows that Swipe can actually be a dead card if there are patrons out on the field.
Yes, very much so. Your dead card in some cases.
Oh, pretty
here,
much.
Making many, many more patrons for your opponent.
Okay, so now turn seven. We've got a couple of different activators for patrons. You can throw down a patron, Unstable Ghoul, and then activate them all. But you do have to worry about dying here in the next few turns because you're getting closer and closer to that combo turn nine.
Yeah, that's actually really, really important to take into consideration here. Yeah, like, as far as you know, your opponent has Innervate in the combo in hand
right
now. So you have to play as if that's a possibility. You don't necessarily have to play around it, but you have to realize it.
Now, I mean, the clean play is to use Deathbite, hit it into the Azure Dragon, and clear it out, but then you just drop yourself so, so low. So the other option would be to execute the Azure Drake, or, you know, just to play down the Unstable Ghoul and use that as your taunt in the way. But does he want to start those patrons? It's whether or not you want to play for the game winning play and drop the patrons, or just try to stay alive more.
Maybe. All right, well, going to go ahead. Four game winning plays here, it looks like.
Drops
the
patron
into the base here. Gonna go ahead and preserving that life total. I can't say that this is wrong at all.
Well, we're gonna go ahead and get in here. Much like everyone watching online has gotten in here already, Arthos. It's almost like they're the grim patrons to our broadcast.
Indeed, they are. That's one of my favorite little donger emotes. Everyone, get in here.
And here we go, we're drawing into more card draws. So another possibility, another way to get more cards in hand, get that combo for next turn if he does want to just drop the Ancient of Lore. 27 health, nothing to worry about.
Absolutely.
Just going to get some more cards.
I mean, there's no longer Warsong Commander, hopefully not, in this deck. So nothing that you really have to worry about at this point.
And thanks to that one mana Wild Growth, he's going to be able to go up to 10 mana.
I like it. With double Druid of the Claw in hand, he has a lot of options coming up. That's a lot of damage that he could deal next turn. In fact, that's a possible 13 if there's no armor up and not this doesn't get dealt with. But that's... I'm pretty sure it will be.
Yeah, a lot of different ways to deal with it. You've got Unstable Ghoul. You can also play Execute and just run a patron into it.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see, what other options are there here? You can play Armorsmith as well on top of the Unstable Ghoul. That's a really good
one. I like that play a lot. That's really cool.
Gotta stay alive, and that's one of the ways it's going to keep you in the game. So, Armorsmith, Unstable Ghoul, and then probably a Fiery War Axe on top of that. Or does he save the Fiery War Axe? He's already been through two Death Spites, correct?
Yeah, he's used both of them. I think you probably just play this and use your armor up, unless you want to, like, hit the Ancient of Lore and execute it.
And that does look like the play that he's going to go for. So just try to play as safe as possible. Yeah. It does lose you one armor by losing the patron on the field, and it denies it from propagating further, but it does feel really safe. And now all of a sudden, the 13 health warrior now up to 16 health and has a taunt.
Yeah, and I mean, no matter what you do here, we're going to see more armor gained through this armor smith. So good plays here by Moody, absolutely keeping his life total high enough here. We do have two halves of the combo for Dominator down here.
Now, one big play is to use the Keeper to either silence the Armorsmith or to silence the Unstable Ghoul to prevent either one of those really strong effects from happening. And you've still got Druid of the Claw, so you can kill something off with that.
And I think what we are going to see here is going to be that Druid of the Claw coming down.
I guess there's not really a whole lot of merit to just playing the Wild Growth, so...
Did he fully think this out? This is something I see sometimes from Hearthstone pros. They start the play, and then they stop and rethink.
Like, wait a second.
I feel like your whole turn needs to be thought out before you make that move.
Definitely. You can see he was thinking about, do I taunt it, do I not taunt it? And I think he also maybe thought, well, wait a second, should I have silenced something else, too?
Mm-hmm.
Because he wasn't going to attack that turn anyway. The Keeper can't kill anything off, obviously, so if you're not going to attack, then do you really need to stop that? You might as well just, like, maybe silence the patron, too. But then that would have given him more armor, so I guess that was the best target to silence. What do you think, Artosis?
I think you're right. It's just, I would have also definitely considered, like, charging this, or, you know, I just think that you have to think out your entire turn and then do it, as opposed to do half of your turn and then rethink. But,
okay.
I like this play coming up. Gain a bunch of armor, remove this 4-6 out of there as well.
Yeah, make sure to... You can see he's kind of a little bit scared of dying here because he knows he's coming up on some pretty scary combo turns, especially if Innervate's involved. But yeah, just going to go ahead, get some extra armor. There comes Grom, and he's going to clear the board, activate that Grom, has a patron and an armor smith. All of a sudden, Moody looks like he is looking at the finals.
Yeah, he's pretty fantastic. He's back up to 20 health suddenly, so... that's pretty crazy here. Has that second patron in hand as well, but no activators for it now. So we're going to have to see what does Dominator actually do to get himself out of the situation. If you look at his hand, he doesn't actually have an answer.
You can't get Doomsayer out of a mounted raptor. So
no, you cannot.
No options for
unfortunately.
That.
Unfortunately.
And it looks like, I mean, to be fair, Dominator still has 23 health. So that is a lot of damage to deal if Moody wants to win. But he's got a lot of damage out there on the board. Now, why do you think he didn't taunt the Druid?
I think he's going to kill the patron here. That's the only thing I can really see going on. Like, I guess he could kill the Armorsmith. There's no reason to go to face, right?
Yeah, so... Well, I mean,
face could... If he goes to face, it's because he's saying, okay, I need to draw Savage Roar in the next few turns. Like, that's going to be about the only way to win if he goes to face here.
Tom might have been pretty safe, but it also might have just gotten dealt with and he would have died immediately afterwards. Leaving Grom up always feels bad, man, but it's not over yet.
Your memery is just out of control today, Rapid. You're fantastic.
Everyone knows it.
It's just so feels bad, man.
Sick references. I mean, I feel like half of Hearthstone is like talking about the cards, and then half of it is like working in as many dank memes as possible. But, I mean, that's why we have Twitch chat for that. They got our back on that.
Yeah, he's going to be a total freak coming up here, but let's see. Like, that's a lot of damage on board. Has little pieces of the patron combo in his hand here, but
my blade be testy.
A lot of threats on the board, so
he does have to clear some stuff for sure.
Yeah, if he leaves anything else on the board, then he's actually just dead to combo, and he knows that already. So just gonna go ahead, keep it safe, and
That is a great drop to get out of there, by the way.
Did you know? So we're prohibiting the new cards from the most recent wing, but they actually can spawn from revived death rattles, even if you don't have them in your deck.
Wow.
That's the next level. I don't know if that's, you know, getting around the spirit of the rules or anything.
That's so funny, because, like, he had to do that. He had to sacrifice his armor smith, which he absolutely doesn't want to do, but Wow, what a great drop out of that Raptor.
Oh, and there's Savage Roar, unfortunately.
Oh, my God.
It's not lethal, but it is going to clear the board.
Yeah, that is so important here, too. And the Armorsmith is gone. Most of the combo's gone. Only one card left. Patron, sometimes this happens where you run out of gas.
This is, yeah, he's running on empty.
Duminator. He's sitting there. He's like, I can't believe I just drew that.
Okay, so basically the greatest card in Hearthstone that he could have drawn. This combo is going to be able to clear the board, deal some damage, and now it's up to Moody to top deck the next big card.
Yeah, yeah, and what is he going to be able to get? He's already used Whirlwind. He's already used two Deathspite. We've already seen at least one Inner Rage used. He might not have any other activators.
And this is the game that decides whether or not Romania or Serbia will advance to the grand finals tomorrow.
Just crazy.
This is where he actually accidentally like plays the combo out of order. He's like, what?
Oh,
no.
Man.
Not going to lose that way, but he is going to be able to. Whoa.
Oh, wow. Well, I guess he's going to take 10 to his face.
Well, what do you think about that? It does save the combo in hand.
I think that. You know what? I think that's really smart. Grommash is your big amount of damage, like your big single card damage, and then he's already dealt with almost everything else.
It always feels kind of strange to say, well, taking 10 damage to the face is a good idea.
Yeah.
But when it comes down to this, these are very low cards, low hand sizes, so keeping cards.
And it's really important because we just saw Moody top deck an activator here, and if he doesn't have the combo, he can't actually get rid of the patrons.
Wow. Okay.
So the game continues to get crazier and crazier.
Oh my god. And especially like if that were a Deathspite instead of a Fiery War Axe, then it just gets even crazier.
Oh,
he's already
yeah.
used those, so he doesn't have to worry about that. Notice we have a Romanian player and I just said he already used.
Oh wow.
So he is That was terrible. So he's going to be able to play down the patron and activate it most likely. You think? I mean, he definitely activates it.
Yeah,
he
has to have two of them out. This is like his last ditch effort. But with that, it's so funny though, because if you use the combo to clear this,
then he wouldn't. Yeah, what do you do?
You're sitting here with nothing also. Like you both just have nothing.
Patrons. Okay, well, Lotheb, great card, but it's not a combo piece, so. You just play the combo here. I mean, you're going up against the patron who, and this is always the problem with patron warrior, no matter what version of it you're talking about, they have like, what, four win conditions. You've got the Frothing Berserkers and the patrons, so.
Yeah, and I guess the Grommash sometimes.
Sometimes, like, if you want to put that
he's
in.
He's gone.
Right.
One patron's gone. One or two Frothings is gone.
I think only one Frothing is gone. Okay, so he's still got one of those in the deck, but you still need to draw activators for those too.
Yeah.
You can only draw one card at a time, and.
It's tough. So. Most of his draw engines are gone. Like he has one more Acolyte in there, but his deck size is really small. He has like four cards left or something.
I'm just kind of speechless. Like, okay, well, what kind of options are we looking for? This is pretty definitely a combo turn. If he plays Lotheb, then...
If he plays Lotheb, that's because he's trying to kill him the next turn,
right.
I guess.
Right. So. I mean, he's already been pretty good at top decking here, but better to just, you know, play it safe, deny one more win condition here. Moody.
All right, what's he draw here?
Oh, man. What is the draw? This is going to be the biggest turn in their IESF
career. Oh, my God.
No, absolutely nothing.
That, he doesn't even have anything that helps, really.
And now with an incredible turn, denying any spells from being played, really, along with other things. He's got a 6-mana Whirlwind in his hand, but Duminator off of Moody's dead draw might just have put himself in the finals.
Well, let's see if he can get a Doomsayer one time.
Oh, man. If you have to pick one time to get it, this is it. He can armor up. He can play the Unstable Ghoul to delay things maybe just a little bit longer.
Dude, I would give anything for
Doomsayer.
Oh, my God.
No way. Duminator, you can see he's got his head in his hands. He knows.
He
saw this happen yesterday.
It's 50-50, man. Either you get a Doomsayer here or you don't.
That's that kind of math I do like. So, I mean, to be fair, for Duminator, that's probably a little bit closer to being true than it is for a whole lot of other... a whole lot of other players. I mean, I feel like when you put Doom in your name, you're kind of asking for this to be a stereotype.
Hey, it already happened to him once in a winning position, so.
Delaying the inevitable. He does, in fact, gotta move right now.
Yeah, he's gotta do it. Let's go.
Oh, my gosh. So here we go, coming down to it. Armoring up. He's gonna put himself way up in life total, though. So 21 health. He's gonna be alive for at least a little bit longer.
He's considering the attack here, but actually skips it.
Oh, and there is a... That's a pretty big draw, too. Able to now silence that taunt off. I think that would have been the second unstable ghoul he silenced this game.
Yes. In fact, it would be. You are correct.
I must save
imagine that. And so there you go. No more unstableness for that ghoul. They're like, send him to therapy. It's like, you're not unstable anymore, man.
It's like, oh, well, that maybe that makes him unstable. His name is even unstable. So take away that big part of his identity.
Oh, my gosh. That's... It's like it's a shell of his former self. But with an activator in hand, we'll see what gets drawn here. Oh, it is an Armorsmith. So,
Is that enough, though?
So let's see. If he plays Armorsmith, armors up, and then Whirlwinds, he's going to get 3 more armor. That's going to put him up to 18 health. But it's also not going to kill anything on the board unless he hits into this Shredder.
Yeah, no, he has to hit the Shredder. It has to be a Doomsayer, I think. Like, even then, I still think Doominator's going to take this game.
Oh my gosh. Doominator at the mercy of his own name. Armorsmith coming out. Probably going to save that Whirlwind just desperately for an activator of something else.
I guess so.
Do you use it here to just stay alive?
I think I axe this 4-2. But see, I'm always thinking of Doomsayer falling out of those things. The amount of games I've been like, okay, that's my only chance to win, and then it doesn't work. I'm like, okay.
If this is the second Doomsayer, like there's a lot of unluckiness on there. In fact, some players who are in fact never lucky, but if Doomsayer comes out this time around, that is going to be devastating. So let's see, we've got 11, 12, 13, 14. Not enough to kill him this turn.
No, not quite. Getting very close here, but I mean, are you just going to face? Are you clearing this out?
Oh my gosh, so much tension. This is supposed to be like a casual card game. You're just sitting around.
The esports is real here.
Oh my gosh. But this is going to be one of, if not our last turn. One of these players is going to the grand finals tomorrow. Romania, Serbia, fighting it out. And this is one of the last draws. Okay, Lotheb, not going to cut it.
No, it is not. That's like he can gain 2 health there, 1 from the Armorsmith. He's still sitting here really needing a Doomsayer out of this piloted Shredder.
Oh
I just
my God. This is such a kind of a contrast to the series that we cast yesterday. That was just like 2 games, we're done, we're moving on, but this has gone
this is
all
so close.
The way. 3 games in a best of 3.
I think this is the best match of ISF so far for Hearthstone.
Or at least the best one that we've broadcast here.
Oh, for sure.
It's so tense. Moody, he's going to reveal that he drew into a Lotheb, and already Doominator knows he's got this in the bag.
Mm-hmm. Well.
Or does he?
Yes.
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 Most certainly does have it.
Absolutely. So he's going to go up to 6 armor. He can actually hero power here as well. He's going to hit into this. Is this a Doomsayer? Oh, it's actually an Armorsmith. Oh,
what
man.
A traitor.
Well, he did, in fact, trade into
that leaves,
the minion.
You know what? Lives to fight another turn. No, wait a minute. Is that Living Roots in hand here.
It absolutely
and that's it.
Is. Okay,
game
there's Savage
Roar
2. Doesn't even matter. He plays the top decked card just to show that he would have had it anyway.
Indeed.
And there you go. Doominator fighting through Korea yesterday is going to advance to the grand finals, the Hearthstone Championship at IESF.
Wow, really well done by Doominator, bringing in 2 really strong decks. I think he prepared very well with what decks he ended up bringing in. And that was so close. What a nail-biting series.
And he doesn't even look phased there. He's a little bit tense there, waiting for some Shredder drops. But in the end, Doominator lives on and will advance to the grand finals tomorrow.
Yeah, indeed. I can't wait until a little bit later on. I think we're going into the StarCraft match next. But after that, we're going to see who Doominator will be up against in that grand finals, which, by the way, is going to be a best of 5, not a best of 3.
Right. So we will have the full Conquest format in effect for those Hearthstone Grand Finals tomorrow, as well as a 3rd-4th place match. So even if you can't go ahead and win it for your country, you can still go ahead and pick up some extra points there in that 3rd and 4th place match tomorrow.
Yeah, so definitely very important for all the teams that are here. And I guess we actually already get to see who made it to the finals here, and it is going to be Mythleta. So That is going to be a lot of fun tomorrow.
Absolutely. So Dominator, a little bit shaky there as he was advancing all the way through the bracket, but you can see he's going to be going up against the Pride of Thailand tomorrow.
Indeed. Forward. And pretty awesome to see that. It's Serbia versus Thailand in the finals. And
who would have predicted that?
You would not have predicted that. You might have said, okay, maybe Romania versus Korea.
In fact,
maybe
if you did
Sweden's
predict
gonna
that,
make
I'd
it.
Be super skeptical.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. Well, that's going to do it for our Hearthstone action right now. We'll be taking a little bit of a break. And then coming back for some StarCraft, you can see that next match up there on your screen with Hass taking on Mystery from China.
Oh, it's going to be an absolutely fantastic match, guys. So make sure you stay tuned in for that. We'll be back shortly.